Hey, welcome to Golden Scratch. So, long time since we made a video. The last video I made was this 427, I think, on the build stand. At the dyno, and we're going to talk more about that in a minute. But the subject of this video is this beautiful 454, and I am going to start this engine up at the end of the video. It's not a very long video, and hang in with me because it's a really cool sound thanks to the beautiful dragster headers that Daryl Waters lent me from Daryl Waters Dyno Service. It's not a big radical 454, but it sure sounds cool with those headers. So hang in there, and we're going to explain how we got to this point. So in the previous video, I used a digital endoscope type camera to show how you could evaluate an engine, and the subject of it was how to determine what engine have you got, can it be started, is it worthy of being started safely, what's in it, and what to expect of it. And the camera was an introduction to that. So look for that. The subject is the endoscope. That's the previous video. You can check that out. And if you want to know more detail, I'm not going to replicate all that in this video. So when we started with this engine back at my customer's shop, he had bought a project car, and it's another 66 El Camino by coincidence. And this engine was in it, and all we really knew about it was that it was a big block. And the engine came with the car, and so it was kind of a mystery engine. So we needed to know exactly what size of the big block it was, whether we could start it and run it or not. So I went to his shop with the endoscope camera, put the camera in the intake manifold, saw that it was a flat tap cam, put the camera in the cylinders, holes where the spark plugs go, saw the condition of that, saw that it was a flat tap camshaft, put a dial indicator on the camshaft and measured the cam lift so we knew kind of how big the cam was. And before we took it from his shop, I had a pretty good idea what the compression ratio was. And when I got it back here, I degreed the camshaft with my trusty, I've got to show you my Mr. Gasket degree wheel. You haven't seen one like that for a long time, I don't think. I bought this in 1969 to degree the camshaft on my 68 Z28. We're longtime friends. It's not as cool and sexy as those great big ones, but it's got a whole 360 degrees in it. And if you're careful, you can get plus or minus a half a degree when you degree your camshaft. So anyway, I use this to degree the camshaft. So now I know the closing point of the intake valve. I know this is a pretty good idea what the static compression is. And I was able to calculate the dynamic compression and what I would expect to get in cranking PSI pressure. And once the engine was started and run, I put a compression gauge on it, and I was off by 2 PSI, which is about a little bit more than 1%. Not bad for a calculation. I probably got a little bit lucky, but it worked out really good. So, point to make is, if you got an engine that you don't know about, and it's got a flat tap or camshaft, don't do a compression test until you've had it running, because you do not want to turn that engine over any more than you absolutely have to until the camshaft, flat tap or camshaft, is broken in. And this engine has a flat tap or camshaft. So by the time I brought it back to my shop and degreed the cam, now I know dynamic compression pressure. And so I need to know a few other things to make sure we can start it up safely. So the next thing is the valve springs. If the valve spring pressures are too high, then that's going to be hard in the camshaft as well. So I took valve springs out, put them on my spring tester, measured at the stalled height and the open height, and the valve springs weren't big, heavy springs. However, to give this camshaft the very best chance of a good startup, I took up every valve spring, I took the inner damper spring out of it, and I removed all the shims under the springs to reduce the spring pressure as much as possible. And I got the spring pressure down to less than 100 pounds when the valve was closed, and less than 250 pounds when the valve was open. So that's gave my camshaft the best chance it could. The next thing I did, you might think it's a little excessive, I took the intake manifold off, pulled on every valve lifter, inspected the valve lifters. One of the things you worry about in an engine that's been stored for a long time is that the valve lifters can rust solid into the lifter bores, and the valve lifter doesn't turn. You fire up that motor, you're going to wipe out the camshaft, and you're going to have infant mortality in quick order. So you don't want to take that chance. So I pulled every valve lifter out, inspected it. They did turn freely. This engine was stored with oil in it. If you ever build an engine and you're going to start for a while, make sure you leave oil in it. The oily atmosphere helps to prevent rust. Anyway, that was all good. All the lifters turned freely. While I had them out, I dipped everyone in camshaft break-in lube, and I coated the camshaft again with break-in lube as well to give it the best chance that I could. So now we've got the lifters protected. We've got the valve springs with minimum pressure. Put all that back together. The other thing we did is the engine had oil in it, like I mentioned, but we didn't know what oil it was. We need to have oil with zinc in it, ZDDP zinc in it. It has to be break-in oil, especially for the startup on the flat top of the camshaft. So we dumped that oil out and replaced it with good break-in oil for the first startup. Another thing I did while I had it apart, I took the filter out and I installed the part number, and this is an empty box because the part's in the motor, but I will put a description with the video. It's a Rosso part number 23845. It's an oil filter screen. It's a little round screen that goes on the top of your oil filter. It's 280 microns. So when the oil pump picks up oil, pumps it through the pump towards the filter, it's going to hit the screen before it even sees the filter. If there's any shrapnel in your engine, if there's any bad going on in there, it's going to get stopped there. 280 microns is 280 millionths of an inch. So it's got to be pretty small to get by that screen. My policy now is every engine goes out of here with one of these on it. And I got another one on order, but all I can show you is the empty box right now. I have the part number. And the reason is it's still back in the engine and it's going to go out of here with it in it. So now I got the right oil in it. I got my oil being pre-screened. I got my valve lifters lubricated. Got my rocker arms, and I got the valve spring pressures minimized. Everything I can do to give it the best chance I could. Well, the intake manifold was off. I primed the oil pump with an oil pump prime tool, which can't find it right now. I'll show it to you later. And they're pretty common anyway. And with the intake manifold off, you can actually see the oil rushing down the valley. It gives you that warm, comfortable feeling that you know it's getting a good oil. I put a gauge on it as well at 50 psi of oil with the prime. Once the intake manifold was back on and the lifters are back in and the rocker arms are adjusted, I primed it again and it got oil at every valve lifter and coming up every push rod and oil at every rocker arm. So I know that when this engine is fired up, it's going to see oil right away. The spring pressures are minimized. One of the reasons we had to bring it here to do that is I have a test stand so I can start it up under a controlled situation, and of course that's what we did. I can set the timing within a couple of degrees prior to the startup. Because I have a lucky fuel pump on my test stand, I can make sure there's fuel to the carburetor so you don't need to crank the engine over to get it fired. If you have a flat top of cam that's not broken in, do not crank that engine over any more than you absolutely have to. And so I was able to do that. Get the engine started immediately. My process is I run it to get up to complete full temperature, 180, 190 degrees. It takes about 10 minutes. And shut it off, let it cool down. While it's being cooled down, take the valve covers off, go through the whole valve setting procedure, and make sure you don't have any collapsed lifters, or if you have a sloppy rocker arm, you know that's evidence that your camshaft is going away. That was all good. I've gone through that process about four times. Already those valve covers have been off many times. And it's good to go. I put more than 2 gallons of fuel through this engine already. It runs nice. And it's ready to deliver. Once I get this video done, I'm going to deliver it to the customer and he can put it in his restored El Camino and turn the key and he's ready to drive it. So that's all he has to worry about. Before we start it up, I just want to cover a couple things that I missed at the intro. Previous video, once again, this 427 on the dyno, that was back in the end of last year. So it's going into 66 El Camino, another El Camino, by coincidence. So we're just mocking up all the parts. It's a nice serpentine system I'm mocking up right now. I've got everything on there. We're acquiring parts for that. Valve covers are going to be changed. A bunch of accessories are going to be changed before it goes in. But if you're considering the El Camino right now has a small block in it, so if you're considering going from a small block to a big block, watch for those videos. We'll cover off all the things that you have to know and do. The other thing to show is my This is a 400 small block, four volt main block that I just recently acquired. The block's pretty much already repaired. I just got the cam bearings for it today. I have all the top end parts. I'm actually going to use a set of GM Performance fast burn aluminum cylinder heads on it. They're the same as the ZZ6 head or the 604 race motor head, and they came off on my race motor. So they're real nice heads. I've got a camshaft, lifters, intake manifold, rocker arms, but I don't have the rotating assembly. I'm working on acquiring that right now. I will be making videos of it running the test stand and at the dyno. I'm building this engine on spec. If anyone's interested, I can build it to your spec. Otherwise, I'm going to build it. And it's easy to get anywhere between 400 and 500 horsepower with a 400 cubic inch engine. It's dollars per horsepower. It's probably the best bargain that you can get. So that's what's coming up next. The 307 that we talked about before, we have made a video. It will be published soon. It's back in the vehicle and the vehicle's gone. It runs great and that's behind us. So next we're going to have to open the door. It's a cold day in Ontario, but we're going to open the door and fire this up and let you hear it run for a couple minutes. And then that's it. We'll go from there. Notice the new wheels on my test stand. Got so much, those big blocks wore out the wheels on my test stand on me, so I had to put new wheels on it. So. Subscribes are appreciated, and keep watching. We'll make some more videos. We try to make videos that are interesting and helpful and applicable, and do that as quickly as possible. Thanks for watching Globe.